Welcome, and thanks for coming to our presentation on Texas Ranger Resources. My name is Nat Norton, and I am a reference archivist here at the Texas State Library and Archives Commission, or TSLAC for short. Before we begin, I do want to thank my colleague, Clint Drake, for helping to prepare this presentation. He was very instrumental in getting these slides done, and I really wanted to thank him for his work. So, what are we going to cover this session? We're going to talk about locating ranger records, how to conduct ranger research, and actually visiting TSLAC if necessary. We're going to give you a little bit about our agency here off the top. We are located downtown Austin, right next to the state capitol building. We always like to share a little bit of our mission with our patrons here on our webinars, programs and services that we provide to our citizens here in Texas. Today's webinar is part of our mission to provide Texans access to the needed information, and in particular, obviously, information that helps you find ranger resources here in our library's collections. We have three service areas that include Reference and Information Center, the Texas State Archives, and the Sam Houston Center, which is actually located in Liberty, Texas. If you would like to learn more about our agency, do please visit our website. You can see the link there on our screen. And I hope you enjoy our Ranger Resource webinar. So the Texas Rangers have been a unique figure in law enforcement since 1823. Throughout their tenure, the Rangers have provided security, military, and investigative functions in Texas. The early Rangers were hired on a sort of temporary basis to protect the frontier, also known as ranging. When we think about Rangers today, we think about them as Texas Department of Public Safety officers. And during their 200-year history, the Texas Rangers have operated under several different names. When we search for Rangers, it often leads to records referring to units called Minutemen or the Frontier Force, Special State Troops, Mounted Volunteers. So there are several different ways that Rangers are referred to, but we typically think of them as the Texas Ranger Force, which was officially established in 1901 as the Texas Ranger Force. Now, the TSLAC collections include records dating back all the way to the 1800s when the Rangers were those citizens hired on a temporary basis, all the way up to today with those modern Texas Department of Public Safety officers. Now, the records of the Rangers are quite varied and include records from the Texas Adjutant General's Department, the Texas Department of Public Safety. There are many individual collections, photographic collections, publications as well. And the two most substantial collections for our Ranger research are these two departments that were off the top, the Texas Adjutant General's Department and the Texas Department of Public Safety. The Adjutant General were during the time period of the Republic of Texas all the way until the 1934. They were treated more like a military operation, with the Adjutant General being the head of the administrative services and responsible for maintaining the records of their activities. Now, in 1935, when the Texas Department of Public Safety took over, that was a new agency that was created specifically for crime prevention and traffic control. The Rangers continue to serve in that capacity to this day, and the collections that we have are from individuals that served during that time, as well as the policies and procedures and the things that the Texas Rangers are going to be what's the best way to say it? What they're actually providing with their service today. The individual collections, the photograph collections, they may have artifacts, publications, different histories of individual Rangers. Most of these records are available in person, depending on the fragility. But we also have a great deal of these records online digitized. And we're going to discuss a lot of these digitized options today. So let's start with the Adjutant General service records. The database is available on the TSLAC website under the Archives and Reference tab, and then under the Reference Services. But again, don't worry, if you're unable to load the database right now, or you're unable to follow with the slides, this webinar and the slides will be posted for your review after our presentation today. Now, when we search the database, we are going to be searching for the different rangers that I kind of mentioned earlier with the different names. In this particular record set, there are 16 series that include the following predecessor organizations to the Texas Rangers, which would include regular rangers, special rangers, loyalty rangers, and railroad rangers. Now, as you can see, we have lots of different kinds of organizational names, and the names listed aren't the only names that would have been listed. I did mention like Minutemen, Frontier Force. So just keep that in mind when we're searching these records, just because you might have heard a story from the past where, you know, Grandpa was a Texas Ranger, he might have been a loyalty ranger or a railroad ranger, and those can be a little bit different. Now, when we search this Adjutant General's database, it can be useful to know that there are some limitations because of the data that we have. These were created from the Adjutant General's office files that were alphabetical, but sometimes they were under another sort of index. And so the names that we have in these service records do not necessarily represent all the people who served. It's just the ones that were particularly in this Adjutant General's service records. And obviously with a 200-year history, there is not a complete list of every person who served in the Texas Rangers. But I do think that if you use this database, you will find that many of them are listed. So when we look at service records, we're gonna have this Department of Service Records database. And if you're not able to see it on the screen, I do apologize, but you will be able to go to the website and look at this database. We're going to do a real quick search here for Frank Hamer, who's a ranger that you probably know very well. He was partially responsible for the capture of Bonnie and Clyde. So if you can see on the screen, there are ways to search by name. First name, last name. We can also do search type, which allows us to do begins or exact. Now, in this case, we know Frank Hamer exists in this database, and therefore we're going to be able to pull up a record fairly easily. But if you don't know the name exactly, maybe Frank went by Frankie or Hamer was spelled slightly differently, you can change the search term to say find any or begins like. Now, when we hit enter, or submit here at the bottom of this form, we are going to get a screen that looks something like this, where you will see that there was a total of one record that was found for the first name Frank, last name Hamer. We can see that he was a member of the regular Rangers. We have a call number, and there at the side, on the right-hand side, we have a image file. Now, not every search that you are going to conduct is going to have images that are related to the search, but if they are available, then you will be able to click on that image file. So let's see what happens. Oh, look at that. So again, we have an image file here with Frank Hamer, the organization, the call number, and I'll go over the call number here in a little bit. But as you can see here on the screen, we do have several different ways by which you can look at the image from this database search. The first is screen caps or thumbnails that you can scroll through. For Frank Hamer, because of his service record and his fame as a Texas Ranger, there are actually 40 images here for us to peruse. So you can download the file if you would like to have a little bit higher quality image. You can view it in your browser if that's more preferable. And just for extra options, if you just want to look at that individual image that happens to be on the screen, you can view the image there or download it as well. So as I said, there are 40 different images from this service record. So from the physical file of the Adjutant General Frank Hamer's folder, there were 40 different documents or 40 different images that came from those documents. This is actually the third document in the service record, and it's his warrant of authority and descriptive list. And this actually contains a lot of really good information if you wanted to find out more about Frank Hamer. So you can see that he was born in Wilson County, that he had a rank of captain. He was 6'3", so a fairly tall gentleman from the 1930s there. And he enlisted there February 2nd, 1931. So this document provides a lot of genealogical and biographical information, and many of the service records are going to contain instruments like this. So while not every record would have 40 images, you will find quite a bit of information that could be useful for a genealogical or just a general ranger search. So with that said, we do have other databases that we can use, the first of that being the Republic of Texas Claims. Now, there on the screen again is our database location. And if you're not able to follow along right this moment, we will be posting these slides and you'll be able to go back and look at it. Now, the Republic of Texas is where claims are where the government authorized compensation to individuals for their military service. So these claims were submitted to the Texas Comptroller or the Treasurer to request that compensation, generally for military service or engagement. And these actually only involve the Republic of Texas years, so 1835 to 1845. Numerous individuals who served as Rangers did submit these claims. And so, you know, when we are looking at these claims, they can provide similar information to what we just saw: biographical, units, enlistment date, height, all kinds of interesting things that might be interested for a genealogical or research request. As you can see, this database operates much in the same way that that Adjutant General Service Record database that we just went through uses. The database contains public debt claims, goods provided, all sorts of different sorts of documentation that would have happened before Texas was annexed by the United States of America. So we have that last name, first name, search type, the same as that previous database. And this go round, we're going to search for a gentleman named Antonio Coy. Now, I do want to point out that, again, when we're searching for Rangers, especially Rangers from the Republic era, names were not necessarily spelled always the same way that we would spell them today. Often names were changed as well. So Antonio might be Anthony, Coy might have been K-O-Y. So when you're doing your searches, when you're doing your look through these records, do keep that in mind that some of these names may not be the way we spell them modernly today. So I do encourage you to play around a little bit with the database and see what kind of records actually pop up. Now, for Antonio Coy, we're actually going to see something kind of unique in the sense that there are 38 records for his name. Now, when you're searching through these records, you do want to make sure that you're clicking on the record for the person that you are interested in. And of course, the only way you're going to know that is to maybe view some of these images. Now, under the results, it's going to give you the total pages there. So you can see that the way that the website is set up, there are actually two pages. So don't forget if you have multiple results that they may be appearing on the next page. So we have this public debt of the late Republic of Texas, and it says it certifies that Antonio Coy was a ranger and was due $195, and there's a nice little circle with a paid emblem there, so we know that Mr. Coy did get paid for his service. Now you're going to find a lot of these claims within the database and some additional records that may we may be able to learn lots of different things. So, for instance, we know that his military service by this document started in Hayes as part of the Hayes Company in the spring of 1842. And since we have that information, we can go to the Adjutant General Ranger Muster Roll Index. Now, this is another place to search for ranger records. These come from muster rolls, and a muster roll is one of the most fundamental records that military units have. They, it provides a glimpse into that person's military history. It lists the officers and the men in the military. It generally will give the individual rank, their date of service, any sort of items that they might have brought with them, and it will identify the terms of enlistment, so the date that that person enlisted and the date they were discharged. Now, the Adjutant General Ranger Muster Roll Index was actually created in the 1900s to help keep the preservation of the actual muster rolls themselves. As you probably saw at the front of our presentation, one of our goals here at the Texas State Archives is to make sure that we're preserving these records, not just for today, but for our future citizens. And so this index is one of many tools that we use in order to make sure that those roles are available in the future and today. So there are approximately 170,000 of these index cards. There were about 1,500 companies of Texas state troops, which included Rangers, that were stationed here in Texas and abroad during the Civil War that Texas participated in. These are transcribed on 3x5 index cards, and they're actually physically available if you were to visit us here in Austin and our reading room that you can use. However, because not everybody is able to come here to Austin, we do have these digitized, and they are available on ancestry.com, which for Texas residents is free, and you can follow the links on our website to find out how to get access to that. Now, many of these muster rolls have been digitized by the Texas Digital Archive, or the TDA, and so I do want to, and we will go over how to access those roles on the TDA here in a little bit, but I do want to make sure that you understand that the muster roll index cards and the muster rolls are using the same information. What is on the index cards was transcribed directly from the muster rolls, so you don't necessarily need to look at the muster roll itself to get the information that you will need. Now, how would we actually locate a muster roll? Locate the index card for the individual. So again, whether you're doing that physically here at our library site or through Ancestry, you're going to look for that card. You're going to locate the index card for the commanding officer. Now, this is really important because when we locate the index card for the commanding officer, that's going to give us the muster roll number that we can actually go look for. So when we want to look for that muster roll, we're going to need that call number. If you recall earlier, I was telling you that I would explain why that call number was important. This is why it's important. It actually tells us where we need to search on the TDA. Now, again, if you're not able to follow along right now, there are instructions on how to search the Texas Digital Archive, and our link is here on the screen. This will go through how we're going to search ancestry.com while I'm doing it here on the presentation, but you will be able to go back and look at it later on. So let's look for Curtis Herring. So this is the instruction page that I just mentioned. You will see there's a screenshot of the Ancestry page where it says search. There's a nice red box around it. You would want to click on that in order to access Ancestry. And again, these instructions should be able to tell you what you need to do in order to find that. So here is the muster roll index card, Curtis Herring. Look at the right side of the screen. You'll see a choose. You want to select the Civil War index. But again, there are so many different indexes and cards that are available. It doesn't just have to be the Civil War. We're just focusing on that because we know that muster roll happens to be digitized. But you can see here, you can search by name, you can search by military unit, you can search by keyword. So I do, again, really encourage you to play around a little bit, search for different spellings of the names. There might be somebody who you are convinced isn't showing up, but their name is just spelled slightly differently. So What did I say at the beginning? We need to find that individual card. So Curtis Herring, oh, look at that. We have his card right there in front of us. He was a third lieutenant of the Mounted Rangers of the Rio Grande Regiment. His commanding officer was John Donaldson. So we needed to know that commanding officer so we could look up John Donaldson's card. Now you can see that in 1861, that is when Mr. Donaldson was charged with being the captain of this Mounted Ranger company. And there at the top corner, you can see 1141. Now that is the call number that we need in order to see this. So when you go to the Texas Digital Archive, you are going to be able to type in that call number of 1141, that muster roll number, and you will be able to see this information. And on the third line down, you can see Curtis Herring, third lieutenant, and all that information that had been put on that card already. So again, the cards do transcribe the information that was put on this muster roll, but sometimes it's really cool just to see what the actual document itself looks like. So those three databases are going to be sort of the three places where a lot of Ranger records that are digitally online, but we do have finding aids, and maybe you want to find out more about Curtis Herring. Well, you can by looking at our finding aids. So our finding aids are off of our website, again, TSLAC. You can go there and look through our finding aids. The Texas Adjutant General's Department Ranger Records is the finding aid I have listed up here on the screen. And if you are searching, we would suggest using the Control F function on your keyboard. You can do that and search by any keyword that is there. These are all fully text searchable finding aids. So when we type in Curtis Herring or Donaldson, the name will be highlighted for us to see. And you can see that in that particular record set, we do have some quartermaster records from 1862 that talks about the claims that were given by Captain Donaldson for his men. So the finding aid will give you that box location, a folder location, so that you can request access to it here at the Texas State Library and Archives Commission. And we have lots of different ways for you to access that. You can come in person, we can do photocopies for you, and possibly it would be listed there on the TDA for you to see already. Now, I've gone through a lot of things really quickly, but I do want to also mention that there are a lot of published histories of Texas Rangers, right? So within our library catalog, there are going to be a ton of different kinds of Ranger histories, both individual and at that organizational level. So please don't forget that by searching our library catalog, you're going to be able to find a lot of different books and publications on the Texas Rangers. So if you have any questions, please contact us. You can do that by emailing at ref@tsl.texas.gov or giving us a phone call at 512-463-5455. We are more than happy to help you with any of your research, answer any questions you have about finding those resources that we mentioned today, or if you're just needing a little bit of assistance in actually using those resources, please do contact us. We'll be more than happy to help. So thank you very much. I appreciate your time, and we'll go ahead and open up the session to questions.